Today I'm taking a request from the comments, and no, I'm not gonna stop doing the show. Someone reached out to me with a link to a news story that's right up my alley. They write, "Your next ep," which, wow, someone's confident, although it paid off in this case. With a link to this news story about 44 state attorneys general launching a lawsuit against the leading drug companies for, and I hate to use this word, but colluding to illegally keep drug prices way above market value. That's right, we're bringing justice to the drug dealers that give that guy in a puffy jacket at the end of my block a bad name. So what's happening?
Rather than enter a particular generic drug market by competing on price in order to gain market share, competitors in the generic industry would systematically and routinely communicate with one another directly, divvy up customers to create an artificial equilibrium in the market, and then maintain anti-competitively high prices. That, of course, a complaint against 44 states involved in that far-reaching lawsuit.
Yeah, wow. Lot to unpack there. First, let's just savor for a moment that 44 states found something to agree on. At this point, it's almost conspicuous that 6 states aren't included. I mean, have you heard of beer pressure? Just look at this court document. The number of plaintiffs is so large they needed a second page. With that, let's get right into it, because oh man, this isn't 44 states coming together to complain about how expensive things have become. When I was your age, the man down the street would remove your appendix for a nickel and a ride home. Instead, it's an accusation of criminal wrongdoing on behalf of the largest players in the pharmaceutical industry. Before we talk about what happened, let's discuss the law though, because there are some important differences between dick moves and criminal acts. The simplest definition I could find comes from Free Legal Advice, who writes, "Price fixing violates state and federal competition laws, which prohibits businesses' collusion. Business collusion is an agreement between businesses that fraudulently prevents other businesses from being able to compete in the open market." So the question becomes, and yes, wow, I hate to say this, was there evidence of collusion? Specifically, did drug companies use teamwork to fight against the free market and agree to sell drugs at artificially high rates? With that,
CBS News has confirmed that the Antitrust Division of the Justice Department is anticipating criminal charges as it continues to investigate whether generic drug companies engaged in a conspiracy to raise prices.
So let me tell you a story. The year was 2013. We had just ended Selfie and Twerk to the Dictionary, because our culture was headed in the right direction. More to the point though, the bulk of the collusive activities occurred from July 2013 to January 2015, according to the complaint, when Teva raised prices on nearly 400 formulations of 112 generic drugs. Let's just be clear here, this action gets filed firmly under the dick move category, not illegal. You can raise drug prices as high as you want to in this country. I mean, if you couldn't, more people could probably afford those drugs. Generally, you'd have a generic drug that can be manufactured by competitors, who, if you raise your prices, in theory would be making the medicine cheaper and steal your customers. Basically, imagine if Advil were $40 and Aleve were $10. Well, there's probably someone out there who's really committed to Advil for life, but the rest of us are going to take the $30 in savings and go with Aleve. Now some of you might be thinking about patented drugs and that whole pricing problem, but that's a completely separate problem that in no way is addressed by this lawsuit, so they're safe to continue ripping off cancer patients for another day. Back to 2013 though, because now we get to the actual crime. A key element of the scheme was an agreement among competitors to cooperate on pricing so each country could maintain a fair share of the generic drug markets. At the same time, the companies colluded to raise prices on as many of the drugs as possible. Ding ding ding, we have a legal activity. Now that's a bold claim to make, which brings us to a very important question. Do you have evidence of collusion?
Connecticut prosecutor Joe Nielsen told 60 Minutes phone logs, emails, and texts show generic drug companies communicating before raising prices. In one text, a Heritage Pharmaceuticals executive wrote to a counterpart at Citron, "We are raising the price right now, just letting you know. Teva says they will follow.
Yeah, you know, letting your competitors know your next move ahead of time. Someone graduated from the Russian oligarch school of business. Going back to our earlier example, you'd think that if the CEO of Advil texted the CEO of Aleve and said, "Hey, we're raising our prices on aspirin," the CEO of Aleve would say, "Great, well, we're not doing that," and immediately start working on a marketing campaign about how his products are now cheaper. Instead, nope. In this example, every aspirin maker would raise the prices so that consumers would be equally indifferent between them. Because if everything goes up a dollar, they're still all the same price. Now, to briefly introduce an ethical element that will have absolutely no impact on the legal ruling of this case, I'm using aspirin as an example, because we've all heard of those products. But this 1000% increase were to drugs I won't even try to pronounce, that treat things like HIV, treat high cholesterol, are blood thinners, cancer drugs, contraceptives, and antidepressants. Wow, that's depressing. Now, the fact that some of these drugs are life or death doesn't make it more illegal, although it certainly does make it more dick move.
43 states and Puerto Rico filed a complaint Friday alleging the companies coordinated to inflate prices and reduce competition on more than 100 generic prescription drugs.
More than 100 drugs? Oh man, that's a problem, especially in covering this. I mean, the table of contents section for what they did wrong needed its own table of contents section. It literally took 6 pages to lay out how they laid out the criminal acts these companies did. Basically, there is no way I can go over the almost 300 pages of this legal brief in the last 5 minutes of this video. What I can do is pick 2 case studies to explain and say, this happened over and over again. First, we have customer and market allocation agreements to maintain market share and avoid price erosion. Whew, man, file that under too boring sounding to be illegal. There are quite a few drugs where this strategy was used, but for the purposes of this episode, we're talking about fenofibrate.
Fenofibrate is used to lower levels of fats called cholesterol and triglycerides into blood.
Exactly. It's a cholesterol drug. At the end of 2012, Teva and Lupin were the only major suppliers of generic fenofibrate, with Teva having approximately 65% market share and Lupin having approximately 35%. Well, that was all about to change when a third company, Mylan, announced that they were getting into the cholesterol game. You know, it being a free market and all. This is where things get interesting, because the exact opposite of what most of you are probably imagining happening happened. You see, rather than fight to keep this new competitor out, they both said, "Hey, welcome to the cholesterol family," and Teva gave the new entrant their single largest cholesterol customer. Huh, that sounds weird, until you think about it. The logic, of course, was to allocate a customer of sufficient size to Mylan so that Mylan would be comfortable with its fair share and not need to compete on price to acquire market share. Man, hope this section didn't raise your blood pressure, because that backdoor deal just kept that price illegally inflated. Now you can see quite a few of these deals going on in the background, giving each other customers to avoid having to compete. This brings us to our second type of illegal act, taking the overarching conspiracy to a new level, price fixing. Now this, well, this really does take the conspiracy to the next level. For this corrupt business practice we're talking about,
if your doctor has prescribed you ACE inhibitors such as ramipril and enalapril, it may be because you have high blood pressure or heart failure or have had a heart attack.
I will say, high blood pressure medication comes up so many times in this case, it'll make your blood boil! So what happened? Well, Mylan increased its price for enalapril effective July 2nd, 2013. At that time, there were only 3 manufacturers in the market: Mylan, Teva, and Wockhardt. They all got on the phones with each other and agreed to raise the price, which, illegal. Generally, this would be the story over, but something hilarious happened. You see, Wockhardt immediately started to have supply problems with their medicine. As it turns out, there must have been a miscommunication between the companies, because although Wockhardt did in fact plan to follow Mylan's price increase, it had not yet had the opportunity to do so as of July 11th, 2013. Man, it was almost a free market there for a second, as the company with the lower prices immediately sold out of their inventory, and the other companies were flooded with price match requests. Don't worry though, Wockhardt apologized for accidentally making a good business decision, and all was made right in the world, when 8 days later, Teva and Wockhardt simultaneously implemented price increases. July 19th, 2013. Now, for legal purposes, they are saying that this is a coincidence. But if you look at this report, well, there are enough coincidences that I'm considering converting to whatever religion the CEO of Mylan subscribes to, because there is something supernatural going on there. So this brings us to the final question on most of your minds. How big is that fine gonna be? I mean, is there gonna be a red spot on their wrist from how hard the government slapped it?
If the Justice Department joined this, it is criminal. It's a violation of the Sherman Antitrust. It's 10 years in prison. Do not pass go. Do not collect $200. Go to jail for 10 years.
Whoa, sending rich people to jail? This is still the American government we're talking about here, right? Now, this would, of course, require involvement from the Justice Department on a case that revolves around collusion. So, we'll see how that goes. Until next time, thank you, and that's all I have to say about that. Hello YouTube, I hope you enjoyed this video. If you want to support independent, nonpartisan news, remember to subscribe by clicking on this floating logo to the left of my head. Ring that bell so that freedom will continue to ring, and give me a thumbs up if you like what you saw. Lastly, as always, thank you for watching.